This is my Bible.
It
is the Word of God, and
it is the will of God
for my life.
I am who the Word says I am.
I'm the righteousness of God in Christ.
I'm where the Word says I am,
seated right now
in
the heavenly realms,
in
Christ Jesus,
in the place
of authority,
dominion,
and power.
I have
what the Word says I
have.
All the blessings of Abraham are mine.
And
I can do
what
the Word says I
can do.
I can do
all things
through Christ
who
gives me the strength.
Today
my mind is alert.
My
spirit is receptive
as
I'm taught the Word of God.
My
life is changed
for the better.
And
I will never
be the same again.
Amen.
Amen.
You may be
seated. If you have a
Bible, you
can open it to
John chapter
5 and
the
series
we're doing
is,
what
did Jesus
really
say?
And
we have been
working our way
through the
sayings of
the Lord Jesus
Christ
chronologically,
and
but we're going
to have some exceptions.
This
Sunday's an exception.
We're pulling
this out
of
chronological
order
because
it seemed like
what the
Lord wanted
to say
to us this
morning.
And
then, of course,
next Sunday is
St. Paul's
Sunday,
which
really
doesn't change
anything
for you all.
It's just a
Sunday we
invite
the
teachers
and
the students
and all
the parents
to come
and be
with us
at
Faith
Christian
Center.
But,
of course,
a message
on
a Sunday
like that
has
got
to have
some
relevance
to
the students
in
particular.
So we're
going to
pull
another
passage
out of
order, but
we're going to
stay in
the same
series.
And
actually,
I
can't
believe
I've
never
done this,
but
I've never
even
heard of
anybody
doing
this,
because
the beautiful
thing
about
dealing
with
what
did
Jesus
really
say
is
you cover
everything.
I mean,
because
he
covered
everything.
Amen.
I mean,
and
if he didn't cover
it all,
well,
he dealt
with it
to some
degree.
For
example, like
prophecy.
So
the
message
is stirring
the waters,
and
we're in
John chapter
5.
And
this is going to
be
a
little
different.
And
I've preached
this
all over
the
world, literally.
I don't
even
know
how many
countries
I've preached John
5
in, but
it
wasn't until
this week
it dawned
on
me that,
you know,
I stopped
a
few verses
short.
Tell your neighbor,
keep
reading.
Keep reading.
Amen.
This
week,
the
German
revivalist
Reinhard
Bonnke
posted,
"I grew
up at the
mouth
of the
river
Elbe
in
Germany.
When
the tide
was
out,
we
boys
played
around
the
barges
that
had
sunk
with
their
flat
keels
into
the
mud banks.
In
my
mind,
they
were
impossible
to
shift
or
move
by
any
marine
engine
or tug.
But
then the
quiet
ripples
would
come,
minute
by minute,
water
creeping
imperceptibly
higher
up
the
sides
of
those
immovable
vessels.
I
have
seen
them
begin
to float
so
that
a little
later
my
foot
could
push
and
move
them
from
the quay,
tons
though
they weighed.
When
we preach
the
gospel,
the
tide
comes
in.
The
immovable
becomes
movable.
The
incurable
becomes
curable.
And
the
impossible
becomes
possible.
Why?
Because
the
rules
have
changed.
God
is
in action.
The
gospel
is
the power
of God.
This
is how
a
day
of
damnation
turns
into
a
day
of
salvation.
Of
course,
he's
talking
about
a tidal
river.
He's
talking
about
a tidal
river.
And
things
appear
to be
stuck
until
the
tide comes
in.
And
then
they're
not
stuck
any
longer.
And
what
I'm going to
do is
going to
be
a
little
different in
this
message.
And
I'm going to
tell
a couple
of
personal
stories.
And
I'm
going to
just
do
what
I can
to
follow
what
I feel
like
the Lord
has
me
doing
this
morning.
John
chapter
5.
And
today
I'm
in the
New
King
James
Version
because
the
New
International
Version,
even
the
84
Version,
just
left
out
a verse
and
a half.
And
but
that
verse
and
a half
is
important
to
the story.
So
this morning
I'm
in
the
New
King
James.
John
chapter
5.
After
this,
there
was
a
feast
of
the
Jews,
and
Jesus
went
up
to
Jerusalem.
Now
there
is
in
Jerusalem
by
the
sheep
gate
a
pool,
which is
called
in
Hebrew
Bethesda,
having
five porches. In these lay a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. Tell your neighbor, they were waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water. Then whoever stepped in first after the stirring of the water was made well of whatever disease he had. Say it out loud. Whatever,
whatever.
Disease he had.
Disease
Say
he
it
had.
Again. Whatever,
whatever.
Disease, he had.
Disease he had.
You know, the young people say whatever. Well, sometimes we give a certain sickness too much credence. Maybe because mom had it or dad had it. I'm not saying that there's any anointing on that word whatever, but there is right here. Whatever disease he had. And so I need to point out a couple of things with regard to this story. I'm sure maybe you don't realize it. But this story, as most of them in the Gospels, took place under the Old Covenant. Yeah, but it's in the New Testament. I don't care what testament it's in. It occurred under the Old Covenant. Well, Pastor, how can you say that? Well, because Jesus had not yet been crucified. He had not yet died. He had not yet been buried. And he had not yet been raised from the dead. And so think about God in his mercy. I mean, if you want to find out how angry God can get, go home this afternoon and read Malachi. I mean, he was angry because they had forsaken him. They had backslidden. And they had stopped tithing. And they were messed up. And then they blamed God. And you know, that's exactly what people do. You know, I saw Dodie Osteen put that online. People make all kinds of ridiculous decisions. They get involved in all kinds of ridiculous activities. They go and they marry the most ridiculous people. And when their lives are all messed up, they point their crooked finger at God and they blame God. Well, God didn't do all that. But think about God in his mercy. I mean, for 400 years, from Malachi to John the Baptist, God did not speak to them. I mean, you know, you might go a week or two or a month and maybe you don't hear from the Lord and you think, what's up? Well, what would it be like for God not to speak for 400 years? But God in his mercy. Hallelujah. Would send an angel. And there was a pool called Bethesda. What does Bethesda mean? House of mercy. Yeah. The problem is it was not at that golden gate or one of those fancy gates. It was over there at the sheep gate. Outside the court of the Gentiles. I like what Jack Coe says. You got to get a way down low to get this. The proud man, see, he's not coming through the sheep gate. What do you mean a sheep gate? Well, that's where they brought their sacrificial animals through. I mean, because it was Old Testament, they were sacrificing animals. So they had to have a gate. And anybody been to the stock show? What does it smell like? Not exactly, like a Presbyterian church. In other words, it has a different aroma to it. But it was in that humble side of the temple. It was in that side of the temple where the Jewish folks really didn't want to even be seen, let alone come and go. The sheep gate over there on the Gentile side. And it's interesting, isn't it, that that's where the sheep gate was. It was on the Gentile side. But God, in his mercy, would send an angel. And from time to time, the angel would stir the water in the pool, and whoever got into the pool first was healed of whatever disease. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I don't know about you, but I am moved by the mercy of God.
Yes.
And I don't know about you, but I'm glad he's not just answered me when I deserved it. I don't know about you, but I'm glad he hasn't just heard my prayers when I was worthy. I don't know about you, but I'm glad he hasn't just answered me when I had obeyed every command of the New Testament. There is in Jerusalem by the Sheep Gate a pool, which is called in Hebrew Bethesda, having five porches. In these lay a great multitude of sick people. A great multitude. We'll come back to that at the end of the message. Blind, lame, paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. Father, that's what I'm doing right now. I'm waiting for the moving of the water. See, they were waiting for the moving of the water, for an angel went down at a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water. Then whoever stepped in first, say whoever.
Whoever.
Say it out loud. Say it this way. Whoever got healed of whatever. Then whoever stepped in first after the stirring of the water was made well of whatever disease he had. Now a certain man, say it out loud, a certain man.
A certain
man. A certain man was there who had an infirmity 38 years. Now that's a long time. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had already been in that condition a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be made well?" Well, what a nonsensical question. What a ridiculous question, but I'm going to ask you that this morning.
Come on.
Do you want to get well?
Yes.
Well, then why do you drag your sorry backsides in here 20, 30 minutes late?
Come on.
Well, I'm offended. Well, you better go to the safer service at 11. Although, really, I think this might be the safer service. Do you want to get well? Well, then how come you just stand there like a frog in a hailstorm, or you stand there like a calf staring at a new gate? See, David is the greatest rags-to-riches story in the entirety of the Word of God. And David wrote stuff like this: I will enter his gates with thanksgiving. I will enter his courts with praise. He didn't say, I'll drag my backside into the house of God 20 minutes late and stand there like a calf staring at a new gate.
Come on. Good.
You do realize this is a full gospel church, don't you?
Yeah.
You do realize there's hundreds of dead churches down the road, right? Well, how come we're not like them? How come they're not like us?
Come on.
Do you want to get well?
Yes.
See, this is it. Because a lot of times, we're like this man. What is this man? What was the thing with this man? And we're going to really, man, I'm going to rock your world with this. Because after the Lord does him a kindness, he rats Jesus out. See, some people like their sickness.
Come on.
And there's millions upon millions upon millions, I'll tell you what, and they like their poverty. And when you start talking about tithing and obedience and the blessing of the Lord, they get angry. Do you want to be made well? The sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. But while I am coming, another steps down before me." You know, it's that doggone capitalism. You know, I mean, I get up and I drag my sorry backside in 30 minutes late and somebody beat me to the water.
Come on.
Jesus said to him, "Rise, take your bed and walk." And immediately the man was made well, took up his bed and walked, and that day was the Sabbath. And I have preached this all over the world, and generally I have stopped there. But as I was meditating on this passage this week, I was thinking about this, that this miracle occurred under the old covenant at a particular point in time which cannot be repeated. Because the word says that Jesus emptied himself of his glory. And then you compare that, Philippians 2:7, you compare that to John chapter 1, and he tabernacled among us and he lived among us as a man. How do we know that he tabernacled among us and he lived among us like a man? Because he got tired and he got hungry. When he fasted, he got hungry. When the day was over, he was tired. So he lived among us, he ministered among us, not as God, but as a man, which means that even though he was God, because Philippians 2:7, he had emptied himself of his glory, he was limited in that time of ministry, 3.5 years, he was limited to time and space, not because he was limited to time and space, but because he chose to empty himself and be limited to time and space. And so when he was at the pool of Bethesda healing this man, he could not be in Samaria, or he could not be in Jericho, or he could not be somewhere else. He was limited to time and space. And I know the reason the NIV dropped that verse and a half, because, you know, sometimes educated people, high church people, they just wig out at angels. Well, I don't have any problem with it as long as I remind myself that this occurred, even though it is in the New Testament, it occurred under the Old Covenant. And I say to myself that it was God in His mercy. I mean, these people were not living for God. They were not living under the Mosaic Law. They were not really, we know what kind of spirit they had because they put Jesus to death. But God in His mercy, under that old covenant, even though He had been silent for 400 years, God in His mercy sent an angel to this pool, not at the Golden Gate, not at some fancy area of the temple, but He sent an angel to this humble place, the Sheep Gate, outside the Gentile court of the temple of the living God. And on occasion, see, they would lay there, five porches, they would lay there, the blind, the lame, the halt, they would lay there and they would wait for the stirring of the water, and whoever got into the water first was healed of whatever disease, whoever was healed of whatever. And so, you all know this, I've told this, about 2.5 years ago, we came home from a vacation, and I just lifted a suitcase in a crazy manner, and I messed up my right shoulder. And so I spent 2.5 years. I mean, I prayed about it when I thought about it. I mean, I confessed the word over it, and I was pumping iron, I was doing everything. That's what I learned from John Osteen, leave no stone unturned. In other words, you know something to do, do it. And I had it about 80% back. But it was there. And about 6 weeks ago, I'm up here on the stage, and we'll get to this later in the passage, but I heard the Holy Spirit say, right rotator cuff. And so that's what I did. I called for people that had been suffering in their right rotator cuff. I wasn't, well, you just did that because, you know, you wanted to get healed. Well, no, but I'm not stupid. And so we had a young mom that was healed. We had a woman that they kept after her trying to get her to schedule a surgery. She was healed. We had a man that had had two surgeries, and they didn't make it better. They made it worse, and he was healed. That's just the ones I know about. But it wasn't until I got home. It wasn't until I got home that I took some motion or did something that I would always avoid, and when pain would shoot through my right shoulder, it wasn't until I got home I thought, well, golly. Amen. See? Golly. We're not anywhere near the shouting point. You'll get there. I will get there. A week ago Friday, I'm over here praying. A week ago Friday, I'm over here praying, and the Holy Spirit told me, he said, get them all healed, and he said, and get everything paid off, and leave a good testimony. Because he said, when you're gone, they're going to go through everything. And he said, don't leave a bad testimony. Don't let them go through your homes and find so many medicine bottles and find so much debt. They're going to think that you just went and hid in Argentina or something. This is what he told me in prayer. He said, get them all healed. These are my marching orders. He said, get them all healed and get everything paid off and leave a good testimony. Because he said that way when they go through your homes, they're not going to find any medicine bottles. And he said they're not going to find any debt. And they're going to find all kinds of money you left behind. And they're going to know these people didn't go into hiding. These people are gone. And then I saw it. I looked over here to the north and I saw it. The day is coming. The anointing is increasing. The day is coming. We will not even lay hands on people. We'll call for the sick, line them up across the front. Austin and I will walk in front of them and they'll be smitten by God and healed. And we take for granted in the book of Acts when it says there were no needy among them, we take for granted that meant financially. I think it meant financially, but how do we know it meant financially? When if you got a congregation and there's no needy among them, how do we know that doesn't also mean there were no people in need of healing among them? No needy. I said no needy. I said no needy. And so, under that old covenant, even though Jesus is alive, he's on the planet, limited by time and space. And by the way, if you search for that word, the Greek word is kenosis, Philippians 2:17, you'll come across all kinds of scholarly articles talking about the heresy of kenosis. And what they say is these scholarly articles say that there are people out there teaching that Jesus emptied himself, which is heresy because that would mean he was God. That's the whole point. And so they waited in those five porches around the pool of Bethesda, the house of mercy, and they waited there, the blind, the lame, the halt, and they waited for an angel to be sent by God to stir the water. But wait a minute, hold the phone and back up. That's Old Testament. Over and over and over and over, Jesus said, I've got to go, but I'm sending another. You see, when Jesus was on the planet, he was limited by time and space, not because he was, but because he emptied himself of his glory. And John 1 says he tabernacled among us as a man. So when he was there healing that one man at the pool of Bethesda, he couldn't be somewhere else healing somebody else of something. But he's gone. But we're in the new covenant. And we're not waiting on an angel. Because now we have the Holy Spirit. And we're not waiting on somebody else to stir the water. You know, if you'd actually pray about stuff, you'd learn things. And so at the turn of last year, I mean, I just had some kind of junk in my lungs and it went up into my sinuses and it got into my throat. And I mean, I suffered for about 3 months. I just couldn't shake it. And then before we went to see Christina and Derek here a few weeks back, I got that same thing. And then it was made worse because Christina is so pregnant, she had the air conditioning set like on freezer mode. So anyway, this week in prayer, I was praying about this, actually after an experience last Sunday, And the Lord told me, he said, well, and he reminded me, he said, well, you remember at the turn of the year, you it was wintertime and the birds had moved on and you took down those bird nests. He said, you remember how you choked and gagged because you'd breathe that junk in? And then he said, you remember before you went to see Christina, you had all those light bulbs burned out in the garage where that switch needs to be replaced and the lights won't ever turn off. And you had the lenses down to replace the bulbs and you thought, well, I'll go ahead and clean those lenses. And he said, you remember gagging and choking because of all that bug junk that you breathed in? See, if you'd pray about stuff, you'd learn things. So yesterday evening in the cool of the day, and thank God the weather broke, Sue and I are out walking around the property, and I noticed two different trees that I paid $350 each for, and some lousy stinking squirrels have built nests in them. And my Detroit nature wanted to go grab me a pole right then and knock them down. But I remembered what the Holy Spirit told me, and I thought, nope, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to hire somebody to do that, but because I'm a Christian man, I'm going to warn him. Now go down to Home Depot and get a mask so you don't breathe that stuff in. But anyway, so I've been laboring under this for weeks. I mean, when Jonathan and Adalys were here, I mean, I just felt terrible. I'm just suffering. And so last Sunday, I'm just trying to help y'all. Last Sunday, I'm just trying to help you also, you know, God bless Pastor Gene, he's up here. Jesus took up my infirmities and he bore all my diseases and with his stripes I have been healed. And you know, well, you were all standing so you couldn't see what was going on, but you know, you were dragging. But you know what I thought? In fact, I told the Lord silently, I said, I don't care what these people do. I said, because I know where the anointing of God is. I know when he's there. And what have I been saying the last few weeks? When the anointing of God is in the room, you have a legal right as a born-again child of God to reach out by faith and say, I'm going to have me some of that. Because if you're a born-again child of God, what is the Holy Spirit doing in the room but to minister to the people? And so, you know, Pastor Gene, I'm just doing my best, you know. Jesus took up my infirmities and bore my diseases, and with his stripes I have been healed, and healing is the children's bread, and, you know, or the congregation. But you know what this old man thought? I'm dancing before the Lord. Doesn't matter to me what you do. Doesn't matter to me what you do it, because I'm going to get me what God's got. Hallelujah. I didn't just come to church. I came down to the house of mercy. Hallelujah. And I didn't even notice until Labor Day. Labor Day, I noticed I'm not coughing. It took 3 months to get rid of that junk at the turn of the year, and it took one Sunday morning at Faith Christian Center. So here's the juice, brother. Those poor people living in that dark age of silence. God was so angry, he did not speak for 400 years. Yet in his mercy, sent an angel of the Lord to the pool of Bethesda, not at the Golden Gate or some fancy entrance, but over there on the humble side of the temple where the Gentile court was and where they brought the animals in. But it was called a house of mercy. And even though God was put out with his people, in his mercy, he would send an angel to stir the water, and whoever could be healed of whatever. Yes. Now think about what I just said, that when I damaged that shoulder 2.5 years, like Osteen taught me, leaving no stone unturned, praying the prayer of faith, praying the word of God, making confessions, lifting weights, 2.5 years, I got it about 80% there. But I'm here this morning to remind you of what Kenneth Hagin taught us, and that is you can do things by the anointing of God. You cannot do any other way. Thank God for the prayer of faith. Thank God for confessing the word of God. Thank God for the laying on of hands. Thank God for the anointing of oil. But brother, you can do things by the anointing of God. You cannot do any other way. And I came down here to tell you this morning in this house, thank God, thank God, thank God, we are not living under the old covenant, and we're not waiting for some angel to stir the water. Because we are born again sons and daughters of God, and we've got the Holy Spirit living on the inside of us. Hallelujah. I have the ability to stir the water myself. Hallelujah. I said I have the ability to stir the water myself. Well, sit down. I'm not done yet. And immediately the man was made well, took up his bed or his mat and walked. And that day was a Sabbath. The Jews, therefore, said to him who was cured, "It is the Sabbath. Is it not lawful? It is not lawful for you to carry your bed." He answered them, "He who made me well said to me, take up your bed and walk." Then they asked him, "Who is the man who said to you, take up your bed and walk?" But the one who was healed did not know who it was, for Jesus had withdrawn a multitude being in that place. Now, he didn't rat him out here. Verse 14, afterward, Jesus found him. Let's tell your neighbor, Jesus found him. Jesus. Tell the neighbor on the other side, Jesus found him. Jesus. They didn't bump into each other. Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, "See, you have been made well. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon you." Oh, Lord. Well, I just don't know how I got these STDs. I don't know how my liver is shot. I don't know why my lungs are messed up.
Come on. That's good.
And you know, the big heresy now is in the church that it doesn't matter how we live. If it doesn't matter how we live, then why would Jesus say to this man, "Go and sin no more, lest something worse come on you"? That's good. That's good. Is God punishing us by making us sick? No, we open doors. There are people here this morning, see the reason I'm, everybody say it again,
whoever
was healed of whatever. There are men and women sitting here this morning and you have accepted your curse. You need to go to Deuteronomy 11, you need to go to Deuteronomy 28, and if you can find your condition in Deuteronomy 11 or Deuteronomy 28, you have bought a lie. You have signed on to a box of rattlesnakes. Some doctor told you that you got that because of who your mom and dad were. You got that because of how old you are, and you have accepted things that don't belong to you. If UPS comes to the house tomorrow and they have to a package for you to sign, and you can hear the rattlesnakes inside making their noise, do you sign for it? No! But that's what we do. Oh, the doctor said, you know, of course I'm going to be all jacked up because, you know, my you know, heredity and, you know, and I'm this age. And so, of course, you know, and we just sign for the package. Say it again. Whoever
was healed
of whatever.
Of whatever.
So I don't care how long you had it. You can leave it right here this morning. I said, I don't care how long you've had it. You can leave it right here this morning. I thought I said, I don't care how long you've had it. You can leave it here this morning. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon you. The man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had made him well. See, this whole pusillanimous, angry person thing did not get created in our lifetime. He was okay with his healing until Jesus said, go and sin no more. And then he was ticked and he went to the Jews and he ratted out the Son of God. Keep reading. Tell your neighbor, keep reading. For this reason, the Jews persecuted Jesus and sought to kill him because he had done these things on the Sabbath. But Jesus answered them. And here we have it. If you get this, your life will be changed. You'll understand church. Nothing will ever be the same again. But Jesus answered them, my Father has been working until now, and I have been working. This explains everything. It explains everything. So Jesus shows up at the temple. He goes to Jerusalem. It's a feast of the Jews. He shows up at the temple. Why is he over there on the Gentile side? There's five colonnades filled with the lame, the blind, the lame, the halt. Why did he pick this man? Haven't you ever wondered these things? I mean, the place was chock full of people. They're waiting on the angel. I mean, I don't know how many, dozens, I don't know, hundreds. Haven't you ever wondered? Why did he do the things he did? I mean, Lazarus is sick. He waits 3 days. Why did he do what he did? The answer's right here. My Father has been working until now, and I have been working. In other words, what he was saying to them is, I'm doing what my Father is showing me to do. Somebody might say, well, why would the Father pick that guy? I don't know. It's none of my business. I'm not God, and I'm not his judge. Keep reading. Therefore, the Jews sought all the more to kill him because he not only broke the Sabbath, but also said that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. Well, they're stupid. I mean, God's my Father, but that doesn't make me equal with God.
That's right.
Then Jesus answered and said to them, and here it is, most assuredly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of himself, but what he sees the Father do. For whatever he does, the Son also does in like manner. But remember again, we're talking about events that occurred in the Gospels, but under the old covenant, the Holy Spirit had not yet been given. The Holy Spirit had not yet been sent. And so Jesus is talking about his ministry in that time frame of 3.5 years where he had emptied himself of his glory and lived among us, tabernacled among us like a man, an anointed man. And he says, the Son can do nothing of himself but what he sees the Father do, for whatever he does, the Son also does in like manner. Well, now the Holy Spirit has come. And so now the key in these services is just do what we see the Holy Spirit doing. Because we can try and do what we want to do, and guess how much success there is in that. But on the other hand, we can pray, we can fast, we can get ready, and we can wait and see what the Holy Spirit leads us to do, and we can run over there. Well, you're just joining the bandwagon. Absolutely. You know, I mean, if the Holy Spirit's doing something over here, man, I'm going to run over here and get in on it. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. If the water's being stirred, brother, I'm going to get in on it.
Amen.
Well, I'm out of time, so let me wrap this thing up. You got your shouting clothes on?
Yes.
I said, anybody here got their shouting clothes on?
Yes.
Look at Zephaniah 3:17. That's in the Old Testament, so it might take you 45 minutes or so. Zephaniah 3:17, the Lord your God is with you. I'm telling you this morning, I don't care how long you've had it. I don't care if it's a childhood disease. I don't care if it's an infirmity you have borne in your body from childhood. It doesn't matter, because the Word of God says in Zephaniah 3:17, the Lord your God is with you. And the Word of God says He is mighty to save. Hallelujah. We used to sing a song that talked about how He is mighty to save. Say it out loud. My God is with me.
My God is with me.
And He is mighty to save. Say it again. My God is with me.
My God is with me.
And He is mighty to save.
He is mighty to save.
He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you with His love. He will rejoice over you with singing. So if you don't understand this whole thing of joy, that's why you're broke. If you don't understand this whole thing of joy, that's why you're sick. If you don't understand this whole thing of joy, that's why you got no sex in your marriage.
Come on.
And the last thing some of you women want to do is let your husband hang around me and get this anointing on him. So there are women here this morning, and you are glad that that part of your husband is dead. I challenge this congregation, and I haven't heard anybody talking about it, which tells me, as far as I know, there's only one person took me up on it. I dare you. I double dare you. I double dog dare you to memorize Psalm 103, 1 to 5, and rehearse it 10 minutes a day before the Lord, dancing before the Lord. I dare you. I double dare you. I double dog dare you.
Come on.
Praise the Lord, O my soul. And all that is within me, praise His holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, and forget not all His benefits. He forgives all of my sins. He heals all of my diseases. He redeems my life from the pit and crowns me with love and compassion. Watch it now. Here comes the juice. Watch it now. Here it comes. He satisfies my desires with good things, so that my youth is renewed like the eagles. Woo! Shout it like you believe it. He satisfies my desires with good things. You know, if you want to get healed, you got to learn to obey. I said, shout it like you believe it. He satisfies my desires with good things. He satisfies my desires with good things. He satisfies my desires with good things. So that my youth is renewed like the eagles. Stay standing. Romans 8:11. When I was a boy, I was thinking, oh, that's why that church I grew up in had such a prosperity. You can't believe, you can't believe, you can't believe the prosperity. You can't believe it. You can't believe the prosperity. The whole time I was a young man, a boy growing up in that church, I only remember one person dying. They couldn't get one person healed in all those years. One person, a mega church, 2,500 people. How did they have that power? Well, one of the things is, I got a revelation this morning. I mean, I'm laying in bed at 4:30 this morning. My alarm's set for 5, but at 4:30 this morning, the Holy Spirit wakes me up with Romans 8:11. But if the Spirit of Him that raised Jesus from the dead dwell in you, He that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by His Spirit that dwelleth in you. When I was a boy, they had a scripture course based on that verse, and we used to sing. Let me tell you something. The world knows all of this, and Hollywood makes fun of all of it. You know, like there were those movies where the guy would hold up the sword, and it was called The Quickening. Or how about this one? May the Force be with you. I mean, so Hollywood understands all of this, and they mock it, and they scoff it, so that when we enter into the real, we feel like, you know, we have to be careful to not get out there too far, that people might think we're weird or something. I was over here two Fridays ago, and I'm dancing before the Lord praying, and Satan spoke to me and said, "You better watch that. There's a wealthy guy here tonight." I said, "You're so stupid." I said, "You're so stupid." I said, "No wonder you're the one that got thrown out of heaven." I said, "You're so stupid." I said, "So what, millionaire? I got that 22 years ago. Hallelujah." I said, "You know, I said, I'm not rejoicing before men. I'm not rejoicing before men. I don't have my hands lifted up to men. I'm not entering the courts of men with praise. I'm not entering the gates of men with thanksgiving. I stand before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. No man can forgive my sin. No man can heal my body. No man can crown me with love and compassion. No man can redeem my life from the pit. And no man can satisfy my desires with good things so that my youth is renewed like the eagles." Hallelujah. I declare that you have fought your hardest battle. I declare it doesn't matter how long you've had it, you can be healed if you'll learn how to stir up the gift of God that is within you. Don't wait for the person next to you to stir it up. Don't wait for Pastor Gene to stir it up. Learn how to let the Word of God come out of your mouth. Learn how to let the Word of God come out of your belly. Learn how to stir it up for yourself. Be healed in Jesus' name. Be healed in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I loose you and set you free. See, I'm wondering what you're learning. I'm wondering what you're learning. Are you just processing this with your brain, or are you letting it get down in your spirit, man? I mean, you want all that God has? Do you want to leave the place? Oh, maybe you're not planning on leaving. Wrong crowd. Do you plan on leaving sick? Oh, God, I can't wait for the rapture so my curse of the law of body can get healed. I hope the Lord comes because I'm going to sink under all of this debt. I hope the Lord comes because I've jacked my life up so bad. I don't see how it can be turned around. Is that your plan? Is that your goal? Or are you saying, "I'm going to enter in"? Hallelujah. I'm not going to wait on some angel. I'm not going to wait on somebody else. I don't need to wait for Jonathan Shuttlesworth to come back. I've learned from Pastor how I can stir up the water for my own self. Glory to God. Hallelujah. 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 Things change, man. You start down this path, things change. Here a few weeks ago, Pastor Sue said, "I got this bump on my body. Had me feel it. Pray for it." Yeah, okay, I'll pray for it. But then a few weeks later, this was last week, she found something on me I didn't know was there. Well, that's a horse of a different color. But I'll tell you what, I just finished out the day. Okay, whatever. I went to bed. But I'm telling you, when I got up, and here's the juice. When I got up the next morning and I started doing what I've challenged you to do, to memorize Psalm 103, 1-5, and dance before the Lord 10 minutes a day and let that Word of God come out of your mouth, I got angry. I said, "I got angry." And I didn't pray some nice prayer. In fact, it was violent. I said, "Father, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I curse that growth on my body, and I curse that growth on Sue's body. And in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command them to be gone." Didn't take a week. Didn't take a day. It was gone. Hallelujah. 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 Tell your neighbor, I'm not waiting on some old angel. Tell the neighbor on the other side, I'm sure enough not waiting on you. I'm going to get in the pool of mercy, and I'm going to stir it up for my own self. Hallelujah. 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 Well, I'm going to work on it. I'm going to get you all healed whether you want to or not. Yeah. Hallelujah. I'm going to get you out of debt whether you want to or not. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. I'm going to get you blessed in your body, blessed in your home, blessed in your marriage, blessed in your finances. Yeah. Hallelujah. So here's the sad thing that's been going on. See, here's the sad thing that's been going on. 2,000 years ago, five porches, pool of Bethesda, waiting for God in His mercy to send an angel to stir the water. And here you've been coming to Faith Christian Center. Some of you dragging your sorry backsides in 20, 30 minutes late, you know, acting like, you know, Joe high and mighty during the worship. You can't enter in, can't clap your hands, can't shout for joy. God forbid you move. And the Holy Spirit, because we've been praying, we've been fasting. The Holy Spirit's here. He's walking up and down the aisles. He's looking for somebody. He's looking for somebody to respond in faith and say, well, thank God, this is not the old covenant, this is the new covenant. It belongs to me. Jesus took up my infirmities. Jesus bore my diseases. And with His stripes, I have been healed. The Holy Spirit's been here all the time. I said, the Holy Spirit's been here all the time. I said, the Holy Spirit's been here all the time. He wants to save. He wants to deliver. He wants to free men and women. He wants to set the captive free. He wants to heal the sick. It's His nature. He is good. He is merciful. He is kind. He is forgiving. He wants to work. I said the Lord wants to work. I said the Lord wants to work. I said the Lord wants to work. I said let the Lord work. I said, let the Lord work. They don't want it. I'll take all of it. I'll take all of it. Somebody might say, Pastor, you've lost it. That's it. We think you stole that doctorate. Go, girl. Pastor, we think you stole that doctorate because you sure don't act like you're educated. Well, I'll tell you what, you can wave a bachelor degree at sickness and it won't go. I tell you what, you can wave a master's degree at a disease and it won't go. But I tell you what, you can let the word of God come out of your mouth and you can lift your hands and you can give a shout of God, of triumph unto God. Well, and of course, somebody might protest and say, well, you're saying it's an act of your will. Somebody might protest and say, you're saying it's an act of your will. Hey, if He didn't want me to know about it, He shouldn't have put it in that book. Because I can read. I said, I can read. And I gave you that verse where it says he rejoices over us with singing. But how's he going to rejoice over us with singing if we are not singing? I said, how can he rejoice over us with singing if we're not singing? Somebody might say, we're out there now. I know it. I'm crossing over. Hallelujah. I'm crossing over. So now sometimes I'll just be walking through the house and I'll just do this and I'll say, I'm being made rich and I'm healed in my body. I'm being made rich and I'm healed from the crown of my head to the soles of my feet. Somebody might say, that's crazy. It's been working. Hallelujah. I said, it's been working. The joy of the Lord is your strength. Top that. And here's the thing. You know, the Sunday morning Jonathan Shuttlesworth was here. The Lord reminded me of how he healed me of the flu in 1985. And we were in church. I mean, I was as sick as a dog. I had the flu. I mean, my knees hurt. My elbows hurt. My hips hurt. Every joint in my body. And I said, Lord, how am I supposed to speak? I'm as sick as a dog. And the Lord said, dance before me and I'll heal you. And so I danced before the Lord and he healed me. And I've not had the flu since 1985. So I was dealing with that junk in my lungs from cleaning out those light fixtures. And I'm over here on that Sunday morning, Jonathan's here. And the Lord reminded me of that. So dance before me. And you know what I thought? I had what some of y'all had. White man syndrome. Because there's nothing as ugly as watching a man with no rhythm dance before the Lord. So I didn't. And so then, 2 days later, I felt led by the Holy Spirit, and this is where I got it. I don't make this stuff up. I felt led by the Holy Spirit, dance before me 10 minutes a day for 30 days. And last Sunday when I got healed was along about day 24 to day 25. God is merciful. And if you can't get, why do you think he has the laying on of hands, the anointing with oil, the prayer of faith, healing by the anointing? Why does God have a plethora of ways for you to get healed? Because if you can't get it one way, he wants you to get it another way. God is merciful. I said, God is merciful. But I don't want to miss him not one more time. If you can say that with me, lift your right hand toward heaven and say, I don't want to miss him.
I don't want to miss him.
Not one more time.
Not one more time.
Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Father, I curse every growth and tumor that is in this room. Father, I take authority over every growth and tumor that is in this room. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Father, I curse it. In the name of Jesus, I command it to wither, to die, and to be removed. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody might say, well, what are people going to think? Look, they are stark raving lunatics out there. I mean, they can't tell a man from a woman. We pay Iran $150 million to do a nuclear program while we're supposed to be worried about global warming. Honey, you think you just set off a nuke or two, you're going to find out what global warming is. That world out there is stark raving mad. So I'm not the least bit concerned about what the world thinks of me. I mean, they're so stupid. They're so stupid. A baby's born in the hospital. They look at it. They look at each other and say, is it a boy or a girl? That's how stupid the world is. I can tell by looking. When a baby's born, oh, that's a girl. Oh, that's a boy. But the world is so stupid, they can't tell the difference. So you think I'm going to be worried about what the world thinks? I don't want what the world has. I want what my Father has. And I pray, I come down here and I deliver the message of the century. And you're like, lame, lame, lame. Remember what he asked the man? Do you want to get well? Well, when they lead you in a song, they're not entertaining you. They're leading you in a song. So how about some help? How about some participation? How about acting like you're alive and not dead?